Hello and welcome to the 15-Minute Chronic Pain Experience podcast. I am your host, Dina Chopoulos, and I am the head pain coach and chief curator at Pain to Possibilities, where we've been transforming pain experiences since 2018. In this episode, we'll be exploring the link between pelvic health and chronic pain. And I should also mention that we do touch a little bit on sexual health, which may trigger difficult emotions. So please feel free to stop this podcast at any time. I am very excited to introduce you to our guest today, who just happens to be my most favorite physio slash pelvic specialist. This is Jill Mueller. Welcome to the show today. I am, as I mentioned earlier, we were just talking a little bit before we press record that we've been waiting about a year to do this podcast. So thanks for your patience and for being here. A little bit about Jill. Jill has been a physiotherapist since 2001. Her interest in pelvic health therapy stems from experiencing her own journey with endometriosis and fertility challenges for 10 years. And I think that's when I first met you. Through learning more about the disease, implementing pain neuroscience and visceral therapy, Jill has taught herself how to escape her monthly cycle of pain. Jill is passionate about sharing what she has learned with other pelvic physiotherapists and her clients and coaches like myself. So Jill, a little bit about you beyond your professional life. How is it that you got into the pelvic specialist?
Well, I think a lot of us who are pelvic health therapists have probably been on the table ourselves, whether it be after we've had a baby or we've gone through some pelvic pain, which are more typical reasons we would see a pelvic PT. And so I was that person who experienced pelvic physiotherapy more from a visceral side for helping with fertility. Mm-hmm. And after that, as emotional as I thought it might get into, it was like I was being drawn to helping people going through this similar scenarios. Mm-hmm. And then once I started to dive into that area, I realized, wow, there's a lot we can do as pelvic physios to help people who are suffering with different issues, as we'll get into.
We had a bit of a conversation before we actually pressed record on this conversation, but I think there's so much power in the caregivers who have been through this themselves. And I know you're also an empath, which is part of it, but it's very much that need to give back when you have seen the results yourself, right?
I think it gives hope. I think when people can relate to you've been there, I didn't even have that I have endometriosis on my bio for about 3 years. I didn't have it on my bio because I never really identified with it. I was like, yeah, I have it, but whatever, no big deal. And I mean, no big deal as in, I just figured if you have it, you have pain. I don't know. I was where a lot of patients were. Yeah. And so it wasn't until patients started coming in and saying, I have endometriosis, that I said, oh, I know, me too. I get it. And they were like, what? And they would like cry. Yeah. And I realized, oh, this is something that really means something to them, to know that I've been through what they're experiencing. Mm-hmm. And right away, they just feel that connection. So I don't want to say I'm capitalizing on having endometriosis, but I think it does help people realize that I get where they're coming from.
Sure. It definitely creates a deeper connection and a sense of trust, which for our community, the chronic pain community. I just had a conversation with a lady I met the other day, just about hope. I mean, we could do a whole podcast on just either the lack of hope, which is just, especially coming out of a pandemic, so prevalent, and that they can see you as a great example and how you've come through and are doing quite well. All right. Just for those who may not know necessarily a lot about pelvic health, how would you define persistent pelvic pain?
Persistent pelvic pain, it by definition is pain in the pelvic area. So whether that's your genitals or your perineum or your rectum tailbone, that has lasted longer than 6 months. Now, I will say a lot of the international pelvic pain societies are looking to change that and are in the midst of changing that to 3 months. And the reason for that is that it's going to get people care sooner. Uh-huh. So if it's 3 months and they come into the doctor then has to say, okay, well, this is persistent pelvic pain, rather than let's see how it goes for the next 3 months. And I think that's important to getting care earlier.
Absolutely. And would you say that's more specifically for pelvic health, or do you feel like there's a move towards
chronic pain in general?
In general. Oh, good. Okay. Mm-hmm. I would agree 200%. As far as the pelvic goes itself, it holds a lot of good stuff in there. So let's talk a little bit about what does the pelvic compartment actually include?
So if we think of the bony pelvis itself, it has lots of attachments of the abdominals and then the lower extremity insertions. So it acts as the support and the balance and acting as sort of the middle ground where the mobility will happen for the trunk and the lower extremity. Inside that pelvic bowl, we've got the bladder in the front. And for males, we've got the prostate that is around the urethra, right underneath of the bladder. We have the uterus and the vagina behind that. Am I allowed to say that word?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Some social media, you're not allowed to say certain words or you'll get screened. So hopefully we're allowed to say the actual anatomical words.
That's true.
And then behind that is the rectum and underneath is our pelvic floor. So essentially dysfunction in any one of those they also talk and communicate to each other through their neurological systems, through the musculoskeletal system, through the vascular system. So dysfunction in one of them could result in conversing with other ones. So you can end up with multi issues in the pelvis.
Right, which I would imagine can get kind of complicated. And I can see where part of the issue comes with our traditional medical model, where they tend to sort of zone in on one aspect and then redirect as to where they need to go next.
Yeah, we sort of talked upon that. Like this is an issue. If someone has an issue with the bladder, they are sent to a urologist. If they have an issue with the reproductive system or the uterus in specifically, they are going to be sent to a gynecologist or a GI specialist. And no one is sort of looking at that whole picture.
Our current medical model, we do tend to sort of reduce to find that one thing. And so what I love about your practice is you're just pulling it together. You're really looking at the complex system, at the human as a whole, right? We're so diverse in our approach. And I think you mentioned earlier too, that you are often the one that will pull those pieces together simply because you are having to look at so many of the pieces.
The other thing that we mentioned before recording is that as physiotherapists, we're blessed with time. Right. I take an hour to assess my pelvic patients.
Yep.
And a lot of that hour is spent conversing in the first initial assessment, getting their whole story. Nobody has given them the time to hear how it is affecting their life and all the elements of that life. And we're going to get into that, but it is not just a physical issue. I think when it comes down to the pelvis, it houses so many organs that our primal brain wants to protect that it becomes quite worrisome when there's an issue down there, instinctually, from a reptilian brain side of things.
Right.
So once somebody understands what's going on, I find it really eases the worry.
Right.
And then we can start to build back up from there.
I was hoping to talk a little bit about the biopsychosocial approach to what you do. And you did have, you mentioned about the biological side and then touching on the psychological side. For those of you who don't know necessarily for our listeners what the biopsychosocial model means, it's simply that pain 100% of the time is biological, psychological, and social in nature. And so what Jill was just touching on is a lot of the biological side, sort of the tissues and down to the cellular level, what might be going on. But then you now sort of dove in beautifully to the whole psychological side and how there's that fear around the pain and what's going on down there. And perhaps moving is hurting or whatever, but how often are you having to deal with that sense of fear with your clients?
Every single patient.
100% of the time. Yep. Exactly.
It's a natural. Okay. First of all, I want people to realize this is a natural human response to something not sitting right with us in our body. Right. It is to motivate us to get us to do something. It's when our system becomes overprotective and we over worry about it, that it becomes this sort of cycle that we need to figure out where to infiltrate and where to make change.
Exactly. What sorts of pain points, sort of the psychological pain points, do you come across? And what sort of words are you hearing your people say?
That they will never get better, mm-hmm. that it is 100% because of the disease, and until they get surgery, nothing will ever change. Mm-hmm. These are myths. These are not truths. Right. Just mostly the worry that it is going to be ongoing. And what that does is it makes them more and more sensitized in their life. So they end up doing less and less and less. And ironically, the thing that really helps chronic pain is movement and decreasing that fear. And so if we can help coach them through understanding pain, mm-hmm. and then titrating that movement, they will see a shift. You can't just ignore it and go out for a run. That's not what we're saying. But if we can facilitate them doing some movement, mm-hmm. and seeing how that their body reacts to that and their mind reacts to that. And a lot of it is education, honestly, and understanding, because we learn and we have still think that pain is a tissue issue. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, it is not a tissue issue. It is never determined by the tissue. It is always determined by the brain. But when they hear a doctor, for example, who does, or someone who doesn't have a lot of time or a lot of understanding in explaining this, it sounds like they're saying it's all in your head.
Right.
Now, physiologically it is.
Yes.
We can actually see persistent pain on a functional MRI, which is kind of cool.
Yes.
But it is the treatment that is going to make the difference in getting out of that, untraining that learned pain behavior.
Right. I'm really hoping that our listeners are kind of picking up our nuances here. Like, we are talking obviously about the pelvis, and so challenges that might come across the pelvis as far as creating pain, but such a big piece of it is just that, the psychological piece and how are you approaching your pain? And do you understand where the pain is coming from? Now, this is where the conversation gets a little bit tougher, but still on the psychological side of things is, you know, if there's any sort of exposure to trauma, and I mean specifically sexual trauma, what sorts of things will people potentially experience with the pain that they're feeling if they've been through some sort of sexual trauma? Or what have you seen in your practice?
So first of all, trauma can come from a myriad of sources. So it can be sexual trauma. But the point I want to make, Dina, is that people think it has to be a catastrophic event in order for it to be called trauma. And I, as someone who has not experienced that, but been through 10 years of fertility, aka being poked and prodded many times, I actually now know, based on me learning, taking trauma courses, mm-hmm. that I had medical trauma, not in the sense that I had anything negative happen to me medically, which can happen.
Yes.
Like birth trauma, or anytime you have a sense of control taken out of your hands, that's usually traumatic. Mm-hmm. But mine were little micro traumas that built up. And what happened was my brain actually, in order to protect me emotionally and to protect mostly emotionally, mm-hmm. I actually unmapped my, from my abdomen down to my mid thighs. I dissociated from that area. I could not picture, when I did a body scan, I couldn't picture that area. I had very lack of sensation. And yet, ironically, I had a lot of menstrual pain. Mm-hmm. But when you understand how the brain, and there's a map of the body on the brain, this makes sense. So remapping that area really helped me. Mm-hmm. Now with people with trauma who, so I just wanted to point that out in the sense that it could be little things that happen over and build up.
Right.
It may not have anything to do with the pelvis. It could be trauma in the past that doesn't have anything to do with the pelvis, and it's stuck in the nervous system and the reaction of the nervous system that we have to deal with. But it can present as many different ways, like a lot of tightening of the pelvic floor. Mm-hmm. Maybe somebody doesn't want to have intercourse, or they have difficulty getting a tampon in. Mm-hmm. They can have excruciating pain down there. It presents in different ways, and because of that presentation, we are going to basically take an approach that's individualized to them. And the key is to always make the patient feel safe. That is the key to any therapy, whether there's trauma or no trauma.
Yes.
What happens is that might like look different in somebody who has a traumatic background versus somebody who doesn't.
Yeah.
And so you might need to titrate back. I might not be doing an internal, well, I guess I should tell people pelvic physios have the training to be able to do an internal evaluation, but I have people who have trauma who I've never done an internal evaluation mm-hmm. on and still made changes. So it just sort of depends. We need to meet them where they are at.
Absolutely. Oh, and that I think the power of meeting them where they are at is huge. And again, you did mention that beautifully earlier, just about the gift of time, but you also have that knowledge. I think that's one thing that we're really seeing, both of us, which was really exciting, is that we're kind of closing that gap between the medical model currently and sort of the integrative approach.
I have noticed that. I will say I have, since I've been in this long enough to be able to see patterns. And in the beginning, you know, I saw a lot more medication. I saw a lot more gaslighting, which yeah. means like feeling not heard by your yes. doctors.
Yes.
And being dismissed and that sort of thing. And I'm seeing that less and less and less and less now. And, right. and I don't know if the pandemic has something to do with it, but mm-hmm. doctors, like they're so bombarded right now. They've got so much on their plate. Yep. Lots of people in pain, a lot more pain, a lot more yes. mental health issues, yes. and they are referring out for help. And so I think the beauty of the pandemic is that it's sort of shifting the medical system slowly towards what it should be.
Exactly. Collaborative.
Collaborative,
yeah.
right?
Yeah. I would even say hyper collaborative. Like that's work yeah. together.
Yeah.
I love earlier, and I'm just kind of coming back a little bit to trauma in general. And like you said, regardless of what that trauma is, trauma has its impact. But the important part is realizing that if there is a trauma history, there is opportunity to work through it. So finding someone who is, you know, someone who can work with trauma, because those unresolved issues, as much as we try to help people, if there's those deep unresolved issues, it makes getting better harder.
Yeah.
And someone who can meet you where you are, like you said.
And I think that is an important question to ask, because we don't need to have any trauma courses. Mm-hmm. It should be mandatory,
right,
to go into pelvic health.
Yes.
But it's not yet. So I do think it's worth perhaps even asking for a discovery call where you can talk to your therapist for 15 mm-hmm. minutes. Hopefully they should offer it for free. Right. Sometimes they have it on their website that they are trauma informed. I've done lots of reading. I've taken courses on trauma, and it is important to have a therapist that is knowledgeable with
yes,
trauma.
Absolutely. Especially if we're talking, you know, working towards recovery. And so yeah. and recovery, not just in the trauma side, but also in the biological side.
Yeah.
Thank you. now that they're getting a little bit more clear on what perhaps what a pelvic specialist can do, what does a typical assessment look like? I know it'll probably vary from person to person, as, mm-hmm. as like you said, you're going to come and meet them where they are, but what would a typical session look like if someone was interested in reaching out?
So we do an extensive questionnaire ahead of time. So we like to get it all down for a few reasons. Mm-hmm. We also make it clear that they don't need to answer any question they're not comfortable with. Mm-hmm. But the thorough assessment on paper to start with allows us to sit with our clients and hear their story at the time. So I'm not like have a computer in between us, me and them, and I'm like clicking away and half listening. Yep. If most of it is down, I can screen that ahead of time, look at what their main issues are, and then sit and listen to their story. Because once we listen to their story, it's apparent what is important to them, which isn't always apparent on a whole page, right? Mm-hmm. So that whole page of them filling out will allow me to listen at the time and just jot down a few things if I need to. And then it gives us an idea of where to focus and what's important to them. Because if they say pain and then they also have urinary leaking and they're like, no, let's the pain I'm used to, the leaking is distressing to me. And I'll be like, okay, so let's focus on that. I'll educate them quickly about that we can address the pain because they might not even know that. But then it allows us to focus on something. Then there is an objective exam, whether that includes an internal or not, because we want to see how much of this is biomechanically driven, how much of it is biological, right? We have to look at this biopsychosocial. So we want to address the bio too, however that looks. Mm-hmm. And then if they have pain, I will probably get them to fill out a few more questionnaires because it really phenotypes where to focus. It allows us to know, is a lack of understanding of pain where and worry, mm-hmm. is that where we need to focus? Or is it a dissociation of the body and a mapping issue like mine was,
right?
Which where we need, because you can't really tell when somebody has pain, you can't tell what is the driving force to that pain.
Right.
So that's where we'll go next. Yeah.
It's so investigative. I just love the work you guys are doing because you are offering A, they're being heard. B, it seems like such a great collaboration. You're working together to be able to figure out, you know, what next steps are going to be, perhaps what issues are. So they get through the initial assessment, and then perhaps if there is an internal, how long is this sort of process take for them typically?
The initial assessment, it's generally an hour. And then I'm determining how much time do they need next.
Okay, gotcha.
So the more complex, the more time. So I do have some people who I need an hour for. There are some people who are 45 minutes. There are some people for 30 minutes.
Right.
So it sort of depends on what they've got going on. It also depends on what they can afford. So I do, unfortunately, we have to think about money, right? So if they only have a certain amount on their insurance that covers physiotherapy, this is all under physiotherapy, by the way. If they only have a certain amount and can't afford anything above and beyond that, then we just make sure that we're, you know, maybe doing more frequent appointments at a less amount of time, or I give them lots of homework. There's lots of variations of what we can do. Yeah.
We have listeners from all over the place who may not have access to you. Do you get a general sense that pelvic health specialists will probably have a bit of a handle also on the biopsychosocial model? Are you seeing that the field is expanding that way?
Canada is doing a pretty good job of it. Okay, because we're trained by someone who is well-versed. Now, it's not the first course we necessarily take, but if you continue to take courses in pelvic physio, mm-hmm. Canada has a really good understanding of that biopsychosocial approach, mm-hmm. and integrating it into the pelvic health. Plus, even at the physio level, it's starting to be integrated into our education system. And I think, honestly, Canada is one of the leading the leading, Canada and the UK and Australia,
Australia
are probably the leading. Yeah.
Okay. That's great. Cause yeah. I'm always thinking about our American friends because I do worry a little bit in the sense that their model is so based upon the insurance companies and what they can offer. And so part of the reason this pod came, such a different system, right? And that's part of the reason why this podcast came about was to, I really want to be able to, you know, spread the message that there are options. A lot of them don't even know that they have the option of a pelvic specialist. And so that's where our interview is coming into today. So yes, we are very fortunate where we are in Canada, but there is lots of information out on the internet that they can start digging into. Even if they do go to see a pelvic specialist and they're not addressing the psychological side, there are resources out there beyond, you know, so go to see a physiotherapist if they focus on the pelvis, if you need to see someone.
I'll give you a resource too for our Canadian listeners. You can go on pelvichealthsolutions.ca and they have find a physio, and that you can find a physio across Canada from that list. And then you can also see what courses they've done. So have a look and see if they've done level three.
Okay.
Because level three is that biopsychosocial.
Ah, there you go.
Chronic pain understanding.
I feel like our physios are kind of leading the way when it comes to the whole biopsychosocial model. So
I would agree.
Yeah. It's great to see. What do you typically see with pelvic health in your practice? What are some of the common problems for men and for women?
Yeah. So I think the cool thing is pelvic physiotherapy is very diverse. A lot of times people will hear about it related to having a baby. Mm-hmm. So either birth prep, delivery options, postpartum. I think if you were to go on Instagram, that's what you would most likely see. Mm-hmm. But it's a lot more than that. So yes, we deal with anything to do with pregnancy, postpartum, whether that be pain, leaking, diastasis recti, which is that abdominal separation,
right,
pelvic organ prolapse. So when I say leaking, that could go for males or females. So if you, that could be urinary leaking, whether it's be when you cough or sneeze or jump or run or activity or just walking. But that can also be fecal as well. So some people cannot control their bowel movements. Mm-hmm. And so that's something that pelvic physio can help address as well. Mm-hmm. We also look at, for males, we're looking at things related to prostatitis. If it, not so much the infection itself, but any residual pain, mm-hmm. any erectile issues, any genitalia pain, mm-hmm. Pre and post prostatectomy. So we have a program at our clinic that deals with teaching guys how to use their pelvic floor pre-surgically, and then they have their prostate removed and the rehab after that, because that does involve leaking and erectile dysfunction. And so we also have a birth prep program. And for women, we're looking at pain with penetration, whether that be a tampon or whether that be sexually. Mm-hmm. We're looking at menstrual pain, again, the leaking, tailbone pain for both back pain, hip pain, sometimes knee pain, these things that haven't really responded to typical physio approaches. Mm-hmm. So it can be very diverse.
Oh my gosh, you're not kidding. And I can see why it would often be missed. You know, if they were going to the doctor who just doesn't have the time to do the full assessment, perhaps for low back pain. And I think you touched on it much earlier in our conversation around how oftentimes we don't correlate, you know, like the IBS pain with mm-hmm. back pain or whatever that might be. You are an investigative guru in the sense that you have to do this deep dive and to understand what's going on. When would it be time for someone to see the doctor? And when would it be some time for them to come to see you?
It's important to see a doctor if you have suspected infection. So like a fever, abnormal discharge, any abnormal odor, abnormal bleeding, whether that be rectally, vaginally, in your urine, those are sort of clear signs that it's a medical issue. Outside of that, if you're leaking, if you have urinary urgency, meaning you feel like you have to go to the bathroom all the time, which I have to say, since the pandemic
uh-huh.
has highly increased. So people will think they have a bladder infection.
Yeah.
They will go get a culture, hopefully. Hopefully they're not just put on antibiotics, because they're not supposed to be just put on antibiotics. But hopefully they get a culture, comes back negative. Mm-hmm. But that's very driven into our nervous system. Urgency is a sign of a heightened nervous system. Think of when we did exams back in the day. Everybody was running to the bathroom. We either had diarrhea, maybe we had constipation, but mostly diarrhea and urgency, peeing, right? So those are signs of that. But the good thing is we have direct access in Canada to physiotherapy. Mm-hmm. So if you have pain that came on out of nowhere, if you have leaking, you can go directly to a physio. Even a lot of insurance companies don't require a note from your doctor anymore.
Yep.
So we will also help you figure out if you need to see a doctor. We'll never just hold on to you and be like, no, you're mine.
Right. Yeah.
So we can write a note and say, I highly suggest they have, and I have, like, when I suspect, for example, prostatitis, I'm like, I think they should get a semen culture, mm-hmm. where doctors don't always think of that. Right.
Right. Right.
So we can help sometimes figure out who to go to.
And I'm so glad you said that, because I love getting that baseline measurement. You know, when you really understand, someone asked me the other day, what do you think is better as far as a diet goes for chronic pain or for inflammation? And I said, well, there really is no better. We just need to get a baseline and understand perhaps where you're starting from, right? Go to see the naturopath, perhaps get some blood work done from your doctor to see where we need to be, you know, mm-hmm. and then you decide what course you take.
Yeah.
Same thing for you guys, right? It's just that clear picture up front as to know, anytime you go on a trip, you need to know where you're headed. And so, when it comes to our current medical model, and again, I believe we're maybe talking a little bit more about the United States, but how common is it, would you say, that there are misdiagnoses happening simply because they don't have the time to investigate, especially when it comes to pelvic health?
When it comes to pelvic pain, mm-hmm. Pelvic pain can be complex, because you can have findings. So you could have structural findings, you can have pathological findings, for example, endometriosis or with interstitial cystitis, which is like a bladder pain. Actually, the UK and Europe is now calling that bladder pain syndrome, mm-hmm. not interstitial cystitis. And the reason being is we can find these structural issues. So where I'm going with this is you could be diagnosed with something, mm-hmm. and those diagnoses are not related to a person's experience with pain. And what I mean by that is you can have lots of endometriosis and no pain. This has been proven. Same with interstitial cystitis. People can have Hunter's lesions in the bladder. So there are these ulcers or glomerulations in findings in the bladder that define interstitial cystitis. But they've found those on people with no pain.
Mm-hmm.
So and this has been proven in osteoarthritis. This has been proven in people with disc herniation.
Yes.
So a lot of times we have these abnormal findings in our body, mm-hmm. and we'll find those on a ton of people without any pain symptoms.
Right.
So that's not to say that your findings are definitely related to your pain experience, mm-hmm. but it might not be the whole picture. And that's where we need to look at phenotyping that pain and seeing how much is it coming from the biological, mm-hmm. and how much of it is a sensitized nervous system. And that's important, mm-hmm. because research shows if we have a sensitized nervous system where it is a learned pain response, where we can see it on a functional MRI on mm-hmm. the brain, mm-hmm. then those people with those experiences are going to be more likely to have ongoing pain post-surgically, for example, or they don't respond to regular therapy, mm-hmm. including physiotherapy, including traditional methods that are not pain science directed.
Right.
So you could have a diagnosis,
mm-hmm.
it just may not coincide with that person's pain experience. So that's where I wanted to say they might be diagnosed properly, but is that what's relating to their experience with pain?
In support of our current medical model, it's unfair for us to say that there's tons of misdiagnoses. There's so many layers to it. Like you said, there may be a proper diagnosis. It's just not necessarily where the pain is coming from. Also, there really are not, given the amount of chronic pain education, at least things are starting to change a little bit, but up to probably last year, they really were giving, 12 hours in their whole curriculum where about chronic pain.
I read a study where 96% of medical schools taught zero compulsory pain education. So that just, to me, means if they wanted to learn about pain, it was outside of what was mandated. It was an elective.
Right. The good news is
I think this is changing.
I think it's changing. Absolutely. And I know the physios are, and pain coaches understand this. And I know that there are some physicians who are starting to push that message, but I feel like right now, currently, the message that the chronic pain community is hearing is, like you touched on before, it's all in our head. And so that is something that we are trying to change the wording on, because as you know all too well, and I'm sure when you work with your clients, you are choosing your words in a very specific way to not, you know, bring on more of kinesiophobia. Like you touched on before as well, that if there are, for example, discs that have been told they are bulging, that does not necessarily mean that brings on the chronic pain. So it's multidimensional, absolutely. And if you would like to learn more about our community at Pain to Possibilities, then you're more than welcome to visit our website at www.pain2 possibilities.com. Jill, thank you so much for all your time. And I'm hoping, oh my gosh, this was such an important topic. So thank you. So we, again, touching on the whole psychological piece, one of the things that is very common in when it comes to chronic pain is this fear of movement. And we touched on that word before. When we say the word kinesiophobia, we're really saying that there is this fear of movement because there is this belief that movement equals pain and pain must mean damage. So when you are working with your people, or how much of that are you actually seeing? How fearful are people of movement when they're in pain?
Well, I see two things. Mm-hmm. One, where people fear movement and therefore are doing less and less movement because they become more sensitized to movement. So it doesn't take as much to give them that pain experience. And then that it's just this vicious cycle that makes us more and more fearful of movement, right? Mm-hmm. But on the other side of that, I have people who ignore their pain and just go out. I mean, think of an athlete. Like right. They just don't listen to their body. They're like, I'm in pain. I'm running my marathon. But when you have sensitization of the nervous system and even just going about your daily activities, you are ignoring your pain. So those two scenarios, both are not conducive to addressing pain. Right. So I have to figure out, is this a person that's ignoring their signals and they're just continuing and barreling through the day, or are they really fearful and need to understand pain in order to dispel some fears and then build back up? So if we're taking that one person scenario of kinesiophobia, and we screen for that using a questionnaire called the Tampa scale or the kinesiophobia scale. Mm-hmm. And you can even get an idea by asking them about their activity level and them the words they use, right? But essentially the first thing to do is to get them to understand pain and to not and hurt and to understand that hurt does not equal harm.
Right.
But to just hear that, you can't just be like, okay,
yes,
I'm going to go out and move.
Right, that's right.
Because it doesn't, you can't just unthink it. You have to go with also what the brain is understanding and recognizing as okay to do.
Right.
So what we'll do is we'll figure out what is their activity level at this moment where it doesn't result in a flare up. So we're trying to find out where is that boundary.
Yeah.
And then I say, if you go over that boundary, you're going to get pain.
Yeah.
And so we're figuring out where is that boundary. Mm-hmm. And then once you find that boundary, you want to do a little bit more each day to start to nudge that boundary towards a more typical looking day. Mm-hmm. Or within your goals. Like, I mean, maybe nobody wants to actually run a marathon, but if you do, then that's our goal. Right. If you want to be able to walk around in your day and do your walk up the stairs to your work and blah, 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 and that's your goal, then we're going to work toward that goal and maybe just a bit beyond so we don't end up in a flare up just at that top step.
Right. Right. And I think you touched on an important point earlier in our conversation, which is probably the biggest word is safety. And like you said, you really are conditioning over time, slowly but surely, the brain to realize this is a safe movement, regardless if it's pelvic pain, whether it's pain in general, is like you said, it's just allowing the brain to believe that it's in a safe space. And so, and in that movement, and then you're right, bit by bit, you're that threshold starts to change and the confidence starts to change. So,
and that goes for the pelvis. So if we go back to the pelvis, mm-hmm. let's say somebody has pain with intercourse,
mm-hmm.
then we are titrating that as well. We are finding what is okay. I have patients who can't even think about their groin.
Right.
So we might start with the feet because if you think about an area, actually for listeners at home who have any pelvic pain, if you think about your pelvis, what happens? If it starts to magnify the pain just by picturing it, that's a classic sign of what we call nociplastic pain, mm-hmm. or when it's been like, that's when we know you could probably see it on a functional MRI.
Right.
And that's okay. That does not mean you're stuck there. It just means that the treatment's different. Mm-hmm. So if someone can't think about their pelvis as a start towards having intercourse, mm-hmm. then I might start with the feet and moving the feet, because the feet are actually next to the genitals on the map of the body on the brain. Mm-hmm. So you can kind of do a sneak safe attack, mm-hmm. not attack, that's a bad word, but a sneak
approach,
a sneaky way to get into being okay with thinking about the pelvis by starting with the feet.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe it's just thinking about it.
Right.
It's called graded exposure. So again, you're finding out, where is that boundary? If you can't think about the pelvis without it flaring it up, then we might start outside of that area or on the boundary of that area. And that's called somatic tracking, which is pretty cool.
Uh-huh.
You've
hit on some really, really awesome points there. Just getting into your feet. So like you said, if it is coming from the brain, that fear or that thought process that is nociceptic and is,
nociplastic.
Yeah. Then that's just, let me just go back a step here. Sorry. What you're referring to, just so that I'm clear, and so our listeners are clear, is there were some MRIs done on chronic pain patients who were under a state of fear. They sort of mapped out the brain through an MRI, what it was when that brain was in that hypersensitivity mode. And then when they sort of reprogrammed or reprocessed that pain process, they took another image and realized that different parts of the brain were sort of lighting up. Is that right? Did I describe it?
So they get more of the brain is going to be lit up mm-hmm. when we're in a chronic pain state, because it's recruiting all of the emotional areas, the memory areas.
Right.
It recruits all of the areas of the brain, or the areas of the brain that are getting mapped and are helping to protect.
Right.
And so
yes.
it's more lit up on people who are in chronic pain.
Yep.
And when we retrain that, when you redo an MRI or a functional MRI, which is totally not clinically applicable, which mm-hmm. is too bad.
Yeah.
But you can see that it is quieter. It is, there's less alarms going off.
Right.
Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's a key point there. The second thing was, what I loved is that you're so intuitive and you know about trauma care in general, but when we have clients or parts of the community who have experienced trauma, they often can't get into the headspace to be able to explain what's going on or don't want to think through that. So you bring them back into their body. So you brought them into their feet, which was a really safe way to be able to move to the next step. So that was also really important. And I say that only because everything you're doing has meaning. Every approach you're taking is based in or on the research that's happening now in neuroscience, right? You guys are leading your patients through all these really important steps.
And I think taking that, like paying attention to the body, is almost a bottom up approach, mm-hmm. a body to mind approach,
right?
Where traditional therapies take a mind to body approach. Mm-hmm. You can go either way, but I do have patients, and psychology and psychotherapy is so important. So I am not dismissing this. I work with a lot of therapists that are it's a great adjunct. And but I do have people who have been through a lot of talk therapy and they're still experiencing the pain. It's almost like their body remembers, like their brain can make sense of it, but their body hasn't responded. So then you can teach through the body safety.
We touched on a while back too on hope. I think this is one of the big words. Other than being such a great example of having gone through endometriosis, having gone through pelvic pain, how else do you offer hope to the people that you see?
There are a few ways to instill hope for people. I think getting them to understand pain. And once we figure out what is the driver to their pain and letting them know that's the only thing that's missing. We need, pain can be changed. Mm-hmm. We just need to figure out what is the main driver, and it can be multiple areas for sure. You can get an overlap of, you know, inflammatory response giving pain versus it being mapped on the brain. You can get both, right? Mm-hmm. So you want to sort of address both sides. Mm-hmm. Establishing a good trusting relationship is important. I mean, someone's not going to be feel hopeful if they don't trust their therapist, for right? Sure. So that's an important thing. I think using the science, knowing the science and talking about the science, I mean, I'm just the messenger then. Right. I'm like, I've read tons of research on this area. We, you know, you and I have done tons of research in this area. We're not just talking off the cuff of our head.
Yep.
We're laying it out that this is changeable. At least getting them back to moving, getting them back to living a better life, right? So once they know that the science is there, they are not different. They're human. A lot of people think, no, but this is different. I'm like, are you human? You're not different.
Right. That's right. That's right.
We just have to figure out how for you. That's it.
That's right. Yeah. At least in your experience, convincing people beyond the biological side only, that my pain is coming directly from my tissues, if they're really stuck in that moment and not believing that the brain is absolutely part of it, how do you pull them into the big picture approach? I mean, I know you can use the education piece, which I think is so important. And that's why we're seeing when you combine education with, for example, movement or treatment, they have better outcomes. But are there any tricks or anything that you are seeing for those who are really stuck in the idea that it's just about their knee or the hip? How do you gently coax them beyond that point?
Well, I actually bring it back to them and say, how is this pain affecting your life? What are you able to do, or what are you not able to do that you were able to do before you had the pain? How is it affecting your relationships? Mm-hmm. How is it affecting your work? So we get into the social side of things. Mm-hmm. Are you still going for dinners at your friend? I mean, okay, well, COVID, we...
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I mean, besides COVID...
Exactly.
When we had a social life here in Ontario, still in lockdown, you know, there will become a time where we are allowed to socialize more again, but are they ready to, or are they more sensitized? So I will bring it back to them to get them to realize how it's affected them psychologically and socially. And I'll say, this is how pain works. This is exactly your point. It does affect the psychological. It does affect the social. Mm-hmm. And so does getting rid of the pain mean you can be more social? Ironically, getting our life back diminishes the pain. Diminishes the pain.
Right.
So I try and say, well, these other areas where that you're kind of avoiding are actually opportunities to help ease the pain. Mm-hmm. And so once we write down all of those things, and again, looking at titrating that in a safe manner. So for example, if they have a lot of pelvic pain or tailbone pain with sitting, mm-hmm. and they're going to a friend's house for dinner, mm-hmm. and they're worried, oh, everybody's going to be sitting, I need to stand up a lot, then it's like looking at, okay, how about you drive yourself, or you drive outside of your partner so that your partner doesn't or you have a key word that will allow you to be able to dismiss yourself if needed, mm-hmm. or you talk to your, like, how close are you to these friends where you're like, I might need to stand up sometimes, or I might need to go lie down. Like, it depends how close you are, but you have an out. If this, then this is my plan.
Right.
Yes. So you just have to come up with plans around this so that it's creating a sense of safety. Right. But socialization has been shown to be the biggest factor in our mental health.
Absolutely. And what have we not had for 2.5 years?
Yes. Right? So yeah. That is an important component to our health, including our physical health. Mm-hmm. So we do want to get that back, but in a manner that is perceived safe.
Safe. Exactly. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. The last bit is, and I know we touched on a little bit before, but I'm just wondering if there's any piece of advice you want to leave people, either who are, if you are living with chronic pain, things that they can do themselves. Obviously, reaching out to a pelvic specialist is really important. You did touch on the fact, you gave them a little exercise where if they just thought about the pelvis itself, and if it brought about, you know, difficult emotions or dissociation, that was a piece
or
of
pain. Or pain.
Exactly.
More pain. Yeah.
Is there anything else that you felt might be something they could either they can do at home?
Oh, I think there's a lot that, I mean, it obviously depends on their symptoms, but for example, urgency.
Yes.
So the feeling that you have to go pee all the time. Let's look at the context around that. Mm-hmm. Did it start in April 2020?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So a month after COVID started,
right.
Did your pain start to do a little investigating yourself? Did your pain start around a time that was stressful?
Right.
And including endometriosis pain. So you could be my age, which I won't name, but like thinking back to when it started. Did it start when you went into high school? Because some people it starts with their first period, but what else was going on at that time? What else was going on? Did your parents get a divorce? Mm-hmm. Was it when you've already had your period, but you started to get pain when you first went to university? Mm-hmm. So just see if the context around your symptoms, including IBS, it may not be pain. It could mm-hmm. be constipation. It could be diarrhea. It could be a flip-flop between the two. Did it start around the context of a stressful situation?
Mm-hmm.
That's one clue that our nervous system's overprotective.
Mm-hmm.
Urgency, if that's the case and you're like, oh, I do notice it, I'm more urgent. I have more urgency when I am anxious about something versus when I'm nice and relaxed. I could, you know, when I'm sitting and watching Netflix and relaxed, I could watch a whole show. Whereas when I'm at work, I'm going every 15 minutes, right? Mm-hmm. So then you can start to try and push the amount of time between those times when you know, I just went, I know if I go, it's just going to be a dribble. Yeah. As long as pain isn't involved, you right. can push those just in case peas.
Yeah, a little longer.
The time of, if it's more complex, if there's pain. So don't do this if there's pain, but urgency and frequency, you can do that with. Urgency, think of this. Urgency actually sometimes has triggers like every time I put my key in my lock or every time I pull in my driveway.
Oh.
So if that's the case, then what you can do is just before you get out of the car to go to your doorway, just there's other techniques, but basically relax your belly, do some breathing, and then on the way up to the door, distract yourself, like look at a squirrel running up the tree or think about math. I'm like horrible at like count backwards from 5, like by from 100 by 5 or something to distract your mind. Mm-hmm. Because it can be like a Pavlovian response, like right. every time I put my, you know, Pavlov's dog, right? So it can be a learned response, a reaction, a conditioned response. Right. So see if you get these urgencies every time you hear water or, you know, if there's a trigger.
Yes.
So there's lots of little tips and tricks that we have that we can give to people. It kind of depends if it's pain or if it's right. urgency or if it's constipation. I have tons of stuff I could give to people. That should be a whole other show.
Oh my gosh. There's so much to talk about. The whole IBS thing. I feel like,
yeah, it's a classic symptom of sensitization.
There you go. Okay. It's staying.
It is. It's been proven. It's been proven to be a classic symptom. It's a central sensitization syndrome.
Okay. That's the staying on the podcast. I did not know that. I really didn't.
Yeah.
I always assumed that,
Same with fibromyalgia.
Yes, yes.
Jaw pain.
Yep.
Oh my gosh, there's a bunch of them.
I actually did a podcast on fibro and just the whole hypersensitivity thing. So thank you so, so very much. Very much for this conversation today. If anybody wants to learn more, Jill has, we have two websites for Jill. First one at her clinic is www.hbpw.ca. Also, she's just launching a brand new one. It's www.endotogether.com, E-N-D-O together.com.